Okay, so continuing on with our discussion about objects, we've got this Mooncraft game that has created an instance of that sailor object, and then we've created some methods inside the sailor object. Now, it's got these three variables that are set up that can be seen by everything in the class. They're called class-level variables because they're declared to the class and can be seen by the entire class. And then we've created these get and set methods for energy. So I've got set energy and get energy. Again, these are called getters and setters, we call them sometimes, or traditionally they're referred to as accessors and mutators. This is an accessor. It gives us the energy, and this is a mutator. It changes the energy. Okay, so however you want to refer to it, those are all kind of the same thing. But we need these same methods, the getters and setters, for the x and y coordinates. So I'm going to go ahead and create those really quick. So it's going to be the same idea. So I'll create a public. Let's see. The first one we're going to do is to set the x. So in order to do that, we're not going to be passed in anything. Sorry, we're not going to return anything. But we do want to, in order to set the x, then we need to be passed in an x coordinate, right? Okay. And then we're going to set this x, the object's x, equal to the x that was just passed in. Java allows us to do that. Again, that's kind of a special situation that Java allows us to do that. Then to return that x, we're going to create a getX method, which is going to simply not be passed anything, but all it's going to do is say return whatever this x is, the object's x. Okay, now same thing for the y. In fact, if we ought to do is pause this video. Hopefully you do this kind of stuff. Pause the video, go in and try it yourself, and then come back and see if you did it the same way I did it. Okay, so this is going to be a set y method with an integer that's going to represent the y coordinate. And all we'll do there is set this y equal to the y that was passed in, and then public int to get the y. We won't be passed in anything, but then we can return this object's y. Okay, so now we've got getters and setters for all of our objects that we have in there. Now do you have to do a getter and setter for every object? No, it's only if you want to be able to modify stuff. There might be methods that only pertain to the sailor class itself. They're not for outside use. Well, then they'd be private methods instead of public. But there may be other variables that you only use within this class, and then you wouldn't need to create getters and setters for them. It's only if you want whatever controlling object that's going to latch onto this object and use it. If we need to be able to modify stuff, then generally speaking, we want to use getters and setters. Okay, so I think that's pretty good discussion for that. Now we can use these again by going into this Mooncraft object, which just created an instance of a sailor, and now I can set, besides setting the energy, I can go in and call the other set method. So I could say set the x equal to 400. Set the y equal to 800. So 400, 800. And then I can print this information out by saying system.println, energy, and then concatenate on. How do I get the energy? Well, I've got to refer to the object and say get the energy. Okay. And that will drop into the middle of the print statement and print out. System.out.println the x, and then concatenate on s1.getx, and then system.out.println the y, and concatenate on s1.getY. Okay, so now if I try to run this method, this is going to be a highly impressive program here. It will set those variables and then print them out. Now, that's not that impressive, other than the fact that where is this information coming from? Well, it's coming from the object created in memory, right? This S1 object that I built right here, that's where that information is stored. Well, in a game like this, you're not just going to have one object. I'm going to start building an army. So I'm going to say, as soon as I say create another sailor, then it will build an object in memory, sailor S2, and that'll be equal to a new instance of a sailor as well. Okay, so now I can go in and set this other object's information. So I can say S2.setEnergy, and that energy is going to be equal to 50. S2.setX equal to 600, and S2.setY equal to 900. Okay. I've now got two separate objects built from the same template in memory. Two sailors in memory as part of my army, and they're sitting at different X and Y coordinates on the board, and they have different energies. They're built from the same mold, but they have two completely different instances in memory that are all maintained by themselves. They exist separately in memory, right? And that's this all this idea of objects is just that idea. Now, if I go in and print out the X stuff, so I'm gonna do something I shouldn't here and just copy and paste this for the sake of you not having to watch me type, and change these to twos instead, then it will print out the X and Y coordinates for object S1, and it will print out the X and Y coordinates and the energy for object S2. Okay, so this is just to demonstrate that those two objects are separate in memory, right? Well, now what happens? Well, what else can a sailor object do? Well, let's come down here and create a public method that's not going to return anything called gotHit, or hit, maybe just hit. If we hit this object, then we need to change its energy based on being hit, right? And so the question is, how much energy does it, are we going to remove? And the answer is it equal for every object? Well, no. If a tank's shooting me, that's different than if it's another Marine shooting me. And so we need to know what's the energy we were hit with. And so we can say, we want the user to pass in a damage variable. And now we can update the energy, right, of this object. Now, again, the energy is going to stick around as long as the object's around. And so I can say, go into that energy for that object and set it equal to whatever the energy was minus the damage that was inflicted. Okay? So they're going to pass us the damage, and we're going to update the energy. Does that make sense? Okay. So I'm going to get rid of all this stuff and just test this out. Okay. So I'll leave my objects being created in there. But basically what I'm going to do is I'm going to say S1 just got hit with an energy of 10. Now what do all sailor objects start out with an energy of? Well, they start out with an energy of 100. Okay? So, if I get shot with a hit of 10, and then I want to print out the updated energy, then I'll print out S1's energy, but I can't just access its energy, right? I have to call the getEnergy method. And notice, so the sailor object starts out with 100, because that's what I've defined. I called the hit method of that object, so it goes out to the S1 object in memory, and the S1 object is going to have a hit method. I passed it in the amount of damage, and it said take the energy that was there and set it equal to the energy minus the damage, so that it'll be updated. Then I print out the updated damage, and it's 90. Well, if I go in and just print out the system.out.println, if I print out S2 and get the energy from S2, notice that it's still 100, because it wasn't that object that was affected, it was the S1 object, right? And so picture what's happening. In every game you play, some sort of, you know, behind the scenes, this type of thing is happening. There's an object created in memory for each instance. And then if you're like me, I like to, you know, one of the, when I was the Protoss, is it Protoss or Protoss? I think it's probably Protoss. Someone's going to correct me on this. That's fine. When one of the most powerful units they have is this carrier, right? And the carrier has little, what are they called? All right, thank goodness for pause and Google. Interceptors. They have interceptors that come out of them, right? And I can't remember exactly how many interceptors they can have, 8 or something like that, each carrier. So what I like to do is build up an army of 12 of those, which is the largest group you can grab, right? Get 12 carriers in a group and go in. So each of those has 8. So there's all these little interceptors flying around, blasting the fly out of the carrier and blast whatever you're shooting. And when that happens a lot of times in these battles, when you get these carriers flying in and attacking, the game slows way down. Now, I don't know if you've noticed this phenomenon in other games. When things get really busy, then the game slows way down. Well, that's because there's all of these objects that have been created in memory that it's having to keep track of, the X and Y and the energy and all these other principles that are pieces of these objects, this information in these objects, and it's doing that in as this game's happening, and so it bogs down the processor a little bit to try and keep track of everything, and the game slow, and not just to keep track of it, that part's probably actually easier, but to animate as well, and the game slows down. Well, that's because it's keeping track of all this information, right? And so that's what we're doing. So we could go now in and create other, army members that we have, army military members, right? Other weapons and that type of thing, and create objects for each of those as the game's played. Then we tie that to when the user clicks on this button, create an instance of that object, and it all kind of comes together that way. So hopefully it's kind of interesting to see what goes on behind the scenes. I'm trying to think of a good, fun example, like I was saying. So just a couple of other ideas before we kind of move on. One is that these are obviously methods. These are things that the object can do, and these are information about the object. Now, what we can refer to these to are properties of the class. So we have properties and methods that we refer to all the time in the class. These are just variables that hold information about the object, and these are methods that do something. Okay, so does that make sense? So hopefully this discussion has been, you know, pretty simple. These we're setting up a template for an object to be created in memory, and then we're creating instances of that object and then updating them as we go along. Okay? All right. Spencer out.